أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء وخاتم النبيين وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. On behalf of the Islamic Educational and Cultural Research Center, it gives me great pleasure to welcome all of you to IECRC's third annual youth conference. And I greet you with the greeting of Islam. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. Today's gathering is very special because we have some special souls who have traveled a long distance to be with us today. And the purpose of IECRC is to connect our youth with the very strong intellectual and spiritual tradition of our deen, which is founded and grounded in the Holy Quran and the prophetic Sunnah, and which has for the past 1400 years guided not just the Muslim Ummah, but humanity at large. And today we're at a loss. We're at a loss because we have forgotten that connection. We have become weak in the connection with our spiritual and intellectual tradition. The topic of today's conference is adab. And as our, mashallah, young, dynamic, beautiful sister, daughter, youth of IECRC, Beti Sadia, mentioned to you that adab is divided into many categories. We have adab first and foremost with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is our creator, Allah Almighty. Then we have adab with the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in which the highest creation is Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But in order to understand Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's sifat, his af'al, in order to understand Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's zat, his sifat, and his af'al, the key connection is knowledge. We are ummat al-iqra. There's a famous saying in the Arab world which says, ummat al-iqra, la taqra. We are ummat al-iqra because, what does iqra mean? To read. The first ayah Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to us was iqra, read. This is why we are called ummat al-iqra. La taqra, we don't read. We don't read anymore. Reading used to be the fundamental hobby of our ancestors. But today, people just don't read. The thing that distinguishes human beings from the rest of creation is the crown of knowledge. What makes us ashraful makhluqat is the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has taught Sayyidina Adam alayhi salam and through him all of the asma. If you read Surah Al-Baqarah, Allah says Allah has taught him all of the asma, all of the names. When you name something, it becomes known to you. When you give something a name, you understand its identity, you understand what it is about. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has taught Sayyidina Adam alayhi salam the names of everything in creation. And as such, being the Bani Adam, we are ashraful makhluqat because of that knowledge. But if you lose the path, if you lose the connection to the understanding of that knowledge, then you and I have gone astray. And today we are in that dilemma. We are in a state where we do have the Kalamullah, the Sifat of Allah, the Holy Quran. We have the Ahadith, but we have lost our connection how to understand them. Adab is an Arabic word, as Beti Sadia said. Adaba yadubu, which means, if you look at the linguistic meaning of it, it means to be well-mannered. But in order to be externally well-mannered, that has to reflect an inner state. The external well-mannerism comes from an inner state of respect, an inner state of discipline, an inner state of being that allows you to have the external adab that is required for whatever aspect of life you are in. Adab with Allah demands that we obey Him. other than Allah demands that we have husnul dhann of him, that when we go through any experience in life, that we attribute the best interpretation of it to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Adab with the Quran is that we respect it, we love it, we read it, and we understand it. Adab with Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is that we acknowledge and we agree with all of the high stature and maqamat Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Adab with your teacher is that you listen attentively to the teacher. Adab with your parents is that if they walk into the room, you stand up and you kiss their hand. And as Sadia said, we heed their first call. So adab with knowledge is that we understand it in the correct way. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Holy Quran that Allah has bestowed that person with the greatest good to whom Allah has given the fahm. It's easy to have the text. We all have access to the same text. We all have, alhamdulillah, thumma alhamdulillah, in today's day and world, everybody has the same Quran. There is no debate amongst Muslims in the text, the matan of the Quran. There is no debate in the matan of the hadith. Matan in Arabic means text. The debate or the discussion comes in the understanding, in the fahm. So what is the methodology Islam teaches? What is the adab Islam gives to understanding the Quran and the Sunnah? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Holy Quran, فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلَ الذِّكْرِ إِن كُنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. If you are in the state of لَا تَعْلَمُونَ, لَا تَعْلَمُونَ is jahalat. If you are in the state of jahiliya, what is the process that takes you to the maqam of ilm? فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلَ الذِّكْرِ. Ask the people of knowledge. Allah doesn't say, if you didn't know, go open up Sheikh Google and ask him. He didn't say, go read the Quran. Allah said, if you don't know, ask the people of dhikr. And who are the people of dhikr? Allah didn't say, ask the ulama. He didn't say, ask the fuqaha. He didn't say, ask the muhaddithin. He said, ask the Ahlul Dhikr. Who are the Ahlul Dhikr? Ahlul Dhikr are the people who truly remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Dhikr means to remember. The Arabic linguistic meaning of the word dhakara is to remember. And insan comes from nasiya, which means to forget. So by nature we forget. This is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has put amongst us the gatherings of dhikr and the people of dhikr. So the Ahlul Dhikr are the people, when we go to them, they are the only ones who can take us out of the state of jahiliya and put us into the state of ilm. They are the only ones who can take us out of the state of dalala, the darkness, and take us into light. Sayyidina Imam Malik radiallahu anhu said that ilm is a noor, it is a light. It is not 10 verses I memorized here and 10 hadith I picked up there. We can all, mashallah, we have a fog. Many people can memorize the Quran, many people can memorize the hadith. But if memorizing was equivalent to scholarship, then the greatest scholar is Sheikh Google. So if you, the Islamic approach is that if you want to have the correct understanding of your religion, go to the people of dhikr. And this is the true sunnah. If you look at the first university of Islam, the very first university of Islam were the Ahl al-Suffah. They were the people of the bench. They were the Ashab al-Karam who used to sit at the Prophet ﷺ's Masjid Nabawi Sharif and they used to learn from him. They were the first students of Islam. And Prophet Muhammad ﷺ was their teacher. And the tradition began from there. They taught their students and they gave them the ijaza. In Urdu, we say ijazat dena. क्या मतलब होता है किसी चीज की इजाजत देना आप अपने बच्चे को किसी काम की इजाजत तभी देंगे जब आपको इस बात की कॉन्फिडेंस होगा आप में कि वो बच्चा वो काम कर सकता है या कर सकती है अब माशाल्लाह खवातीन बैठी अगर आपने कोई अपने बच्ची को कोई डिश पकाना सिखा दिया आप किस वक्त आप में वो कॉन्फिडेंस आएगा कि हाँ इसने ये बात सीख ली इसने ये डिश सीख लिया जब वो सीख करके आपको डिश पका करके आपको मुतमईन ना कर दे आप उसको इजाजत नहीं दे सकती कि यार तुम अगले दावत के लिए खाना पका दो देंगे आप इजाजत? नहीं देंगे ना? तो ये तो मामूली खाने की बात है, यहां दीन की बात हो रही है। दीन को समझकर, समझाकर, फिर उसका इम्तिहान लेकर जब आपने अपने उस अपने स्टूडेंट को क्वालिफाई कर दिया, सर्टिफाई कर दिया, तब उसके पास वो इजाजत होती है कि उस इल्म को वो अगले जनरेशन तक पहुंचाए। Maybe our youth are not aware, but do you know the certification system that we go through in our universities? It has come from Islam. The whole concept of certification, you get a certificate. What does a certificate mean? It means that you are now authorized in this piece of knowledge. You are now authorized in this skill, that you now have the ability to do it independently. You have the competence to now do it independently, and that you can transfer it to someone else. This concept has come from Islam. Lekin aaj knowledge is just for sale. It's hanging on the roads. Anybody can just go pick up an ayah of the Quran and think and say whatever they think about it. Anybody can pick a hadith and they can interpret any way they want it and apply it in their lives and force others to start applying it. This is chaos in the world of knowledge. Adab and knowledge is that you must go and sit at the feet of your sheikh. There is another very important saying of Sayyidina Imam Malik radiallahu anhu, when he said, learn adab before knowledge. As a matter of fact, his own mother, when he was a child, his mother told him to go and learn knowledge from a very big sheikh of his time. His name was Rabia al-Ray. And she said, idhab ila Rabia, go to Rabia. And she said, first take his adab, then take his knowledge. Because remember, Shaitan had a lot of knowledge. Shaitan, we all know, had a lot of knowledge. He was a jinn. He is a jinn. He is a jinn, but the reason Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made him the head of the malaika is because of his knowledge. He had the ilm. But what he didn't have, Bismillah. Ahla wa sahlan. Assalamu alaikum. What he didn't have, what Shaitan didn't have, was adab. So all of his knowledge which got him to the top of the rank, he became the top of the malaika. He became the top grade officer in all the jinnah and the malaika. But what got him thrown out of heaven was his adabi with Allah. Allah said, bow down to Adam alayhi salam. He said, why? I am better than him. He's made of clay, I'm made of fire. So what entered into him, because of his adabi, what entered into him was takabbur, which is the absolute opposite of adab. So if we want to come back to the tradition of Islam, the tradition of that noor, to have that knowledge really enlighten our batin, because remember, youth, your zahir can only be enlightened once your batin is enlightened. You can only have true adab in your actions if your inner being is purified. And this is the component of ihsan. If you have studied Hadith Jibreel, Islam has three components. I'll talk a little bit in scientific language. You know, you have the three axes, the x-axis, the y-axis, and the z-axis. Well, your x-axis is your Islam. It is the horizontal axis where you do all of the physical ibadat related to Islam, your salah, your zakah, your hajj, your saum, and all of that comes under Islam. The y-axis is the vertical axis. It is your iman. It is your the depth of your iman. Because you can do salah. You can have salah X today and salah X tomorrow. And there's a big difference between those two salahs. Because your state of iman was different. One day you were in complete concentration. The other day you were thinking about, I don't know, the IPL or God knows whatever people think about when the exam and when you start praying. And the Z axis is the ihsan. This is the element of ihsan. It is the element of the heart. It is the batin. And unless you have that depth in your being, we cannot have true external adab. So if you want adab to reflect from your face and your body and your being, then the true adab begins from inside. Now I'll just end with one hadith. I know my time is up, but I think it's a very important hadith. Of course, all hadith are important. But this is in relation to our parents. Because what this hadith says, الصلاح من الله والأدب من الآباء. Which means, الصلاح means good actions. Correct actions are from Allah. So Allah is the only one who can give us tawfiq to do good actions. But الأدب من الآباء. Adab comes from parents. Why? Why does adab come from parents? Because we are creatures that learn from observation. And this is also proven in modern psychological theory. There is this theory of social learning. If you've studied psychology, you've heard of Bandura. Modern psychology, social learning theory has two components, observation and modeling. You learn through observation. So when you see your mother turning the pages of the Quran with a lot of respect, you see your mother putting it up on a shelf, and you see your father praying with a lot of adab and making a special arrangement for his salah, and you see your parents eating at the dinner table with a lot of respect. When you observe, when the child observes these things, they imbibe it. You cannot put your child in front of the TV and then come and complain to the sheikh, oh sheikh, my son has no adab. Well, you put the son in front of the TV, you know, what else is he going to observe? And the second aspect is modeling, means we need role models. And who is our role model? Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is our role model. This is why we must increase our love for Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When we increase our love for Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he becomes our true role model. So if we want our children's adab to improve, if we want our societal adab to improve, we must give them good examples. We must create our homes should be havens of noor. And for your homes to be havens of noor, you must conduct these gatherings of dhikr. Majalis of dhikr, this is mentioned in Bukhari Sharif, and it is in these gatherings of dhikr that the malaika come. So not only is the child or the youth observing their parents with a lot of adab, they are surrounded by the creations that are made of light. And when we are in the company of light, we get enlightened. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the tawfiq to learn adab in the correct way. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the adab to acquire knowledge in the way that gives us the true fahm, so that we can be of those who are truly purified in our batin and truly show adab in our zahir. وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين.